Hi, I'm going to present Authorized Entities Directory. In the short form, it's called AEDIR, with this strange Unicode character there, you know, so it's, yeah, depending on the language, it's Scandinavian or very old German or something. It's for challenging the Unicode capabilities in software a little bit. It already failed on the Freenode in some chat clients. Okay. Authorized Entities Directory is mainly a user management based on OpenLDAP. And yeah. So it's me, I'm doing stuff. The reason why Authorized Entities Directory exists is that I was in a customer project, and the security guys said, okay, your LDAP-based management, your LDAP-based user management is quite some, it's quite good, you know, but you should take care of that users and groups should only be visible on systems where they have to be visible. And we all know these principles, basically general security requirements you can read in every security concept. You know, so everybody is writing it down in their security policy. Oh, we are following need to know principle. We are following least privilege principle. But I scratched my head and I thought to myself, well, all the directory solutions, all the user management solutions are not really following these principles. So if, for example, if you attach all your Linux systems to an Active Directory, be aware that every user and every system sees almost everything. There are only very few exceptions of data in the Active Directory tree which are hidden behind access control rules. But basically, you can, in every company using Active Directory, every user can query who are the members of the super-duper admin group and how and what's their mobile number. You know, so I'm seeing a lot of Active Directory deployments where all contact data is also put in there. You know, so this is for social engineering attacks or preparing attacks. That's a very useful source, you know. So I looked around for alternatives, and I don't want to mention other projects, but all the alternatives and the systems I set up before myself, you know, they all focus on providing data. They're not focusing on hiding data. So. So I had to build a system like this myself. And another aspect why this exists is that I wanted to have a system where you can consequently delegate the task of data maintenance to other people. So in practice, you have this help desk, proxy roles, you know, you are users write a ticket, I need access to this resource, and so a help desk user has the right to put you into a certain permissions group and things like that, you know, but this is always a workflow, you know, it's a workflow. But I want to delegate this task, so whoever is authorized to decide whether somebody gets access to a resource, he or she should just do it, you know? And of course, what you need in such a system is meaningful audit trails. You have to record who did what, you know, and for doing compliance checks afterwards. Well, there's a buzzword called DevOps since quite some years now, and there's another buzzword saying SecDevOps, and well, I would say you cannot do really good DevOps without the security in there, you know, and therefore it means that if you have several teams maintaining systems for several projects, you know, you have to implement, you have to define security policies and really enforce those security policies in a fine-grained way. And the separation of the systems could be inspired by, for example, a network separation you already have, or can be inspired by organizational structure, or can be inspired also by the staging of your systems. For example, you have development systems, test systems, or production systems, and this is one dimension how to structure your access control policy. So, and a system to be, so the system I wanted to design has to be flexible enough to accommodate all those dimensions. You know, so it has to be free enough for you to decide yourself which structure your access control has. Yeah, as said before, you know, the normal thing is you trigger a workflow to get access to a resource, but that's not really agile. Agile is another buzzword, you know. And I'm trying here to really eliminate workflows. Just say somebody is authorized to decide, so he's authorized to do it technically, him or herself. So for this delegation, you obviously also need fine-grained authorization structures. So, just to summarize a few of the paradigms I try to following with this system is explicit is better than implicit. So, everything has to be really made explicitly available. It's not just available because somebody has an account or something. So, so obviously this requires that everything you want to authorize, the entities, all the entities have to securely authenticate to get access to data or to some function. A paradigm which is really hard to follow is to avoid almighty proxy roles. In practice, you, for example, if you have an identity management system, the identity management system is mainly a huge database with a lot of connectors, and those connectors have they pump data into the target systems, and they have very strong, powerful rights, access rights. You know, mainly they are God in the target systems. And once your connector gets hacked, you know, the attacker is, yeah, he has every access right in the target. One also very, very important paradigm is to avoid to structure access rights based on hierarchy. So in Active Directory, for example, delegation is it's somewhat flexible, but the structure, how you structure your objects, the resources, it's hierarchical, strictly hierarchical along the so-called OU structure. And I didn't want that. So another important point is that this system distinguishes strictly between person objects and their connected user objects. So a person is not an user account. It does not even have a password. It's just a person object. So, and you can have multiple user accounts tied to this person object. And one very strict paradigm is that IDs assigned, for example, to users and to groups are never reused. So basically, there's nothing really removed inside there. Better to say, user accounts and groups are never reused. Yeah? So to keep their IDs persistent. So, this is a picture of the system architecture, and basically, here on the right top corner, there's a system where's running a writable replica, a writable instance of the open LDAP server daemon called Slabd, and I use the pointer, and mainly the system is maintained. The data is maintained either directly over LDAP or through in the web app. So the official API for maintaining data for doing mass data maintenance is really direct LDAP access. The reason for this is that all the access control is implemented by open LDAP access control lists. So there's no proxy or something enforcing security policy. It's just the open LDAP server itself. There are some web apps, one very powerful web app, and then another web app, for example, for password self-service, and then another simple web app for enrolling YubiKey tokens. And a bunch of cron jobs maintaining data. For example, a typical scenario would say you have an HR system where your personal data is, and one of the maintenance jobs syncs person data into the system as person objects. So, and here are the so-called consumer replicas. It's just a replicated instance of the open LDAP server, you know. But below this red line, all the replicas are read-only. So you cannot write there, you know. You cannot alter data there, you know. That's for security reasons. So you have a two-tier architecture with writable provider replicas and read-only consumer replicas. Also, some of the data is not available on the consumers because it does not have to be there. For example, shared secrets for the two-factor authentication. So, and typically, the admin would go to a Unix server, for example, doing login there, you know, and you have the usual PAM NSS access over LDAP querying the data. Okay, I said the access control is not based on hierarchical data, and that's indeed the case, but of course, that's an LDAP server, so the data is hierarchically organized. On the below the top level, you have the so-called zones. Zones are just areas of delegated administration, can be anything, can be inspired by your stages or can be inspired by your teams or a mixture of everything. It's just the level below the root node is just zones. And there are special zones. For example, there's a pub zone. A pub zone contains data which can be read by any authenticated user. And there's also a special zone for administering the system itself. It's self-contained. Yeah? The system is maintained with itself. And within a zone, like here, the example zone, you have users and user groups, and you have service groups, you have pseudo rules, and you have special user groups which which make up the roles acting within the zone for delegating maintenance zone maintenance. Below the service groups, you can have host objects or server services objects. And below the host objects, you can even store network device data if you want that. That's optional. So, this is the shocking picture of the complete entity relationship diagram. As you can see nothing. And so I have a more friendly version of it. Yeah, it's an excerpt of the former one. And this is the this is the most important picture for understanding how the access control within the system works. And basically, and a very central element is the so-called service group. A service group is, you can say, a clustered service, for example, or you could also say the abstraction level is a host, a group of hosts, where you want to apply the same security policy. And basically, the security policy is, defining the security policy is setting links to user groups. And this is this arrow, yeah. And the picture you have to read like this. Within the name within the square, it's the name of the object class of the LDAP entry, and basically you have pointers which are just the distinguished names of other referenced entries, and you can see here you can have several attributes containing references to other entries, and service groups are referencing user groups. And those user groups can also have members, which can be personal user accounts, which are connected to a person object, or tool accounts, service accounts, whatever you like to call it. So in the beginning I said the most important part is really the need-to-know principle, enforcing a need-to-know principle. And this is done by each host must authenticate itself to the system and is then member of a service group. And this service group, you have to set this attribute AE visible groups to make a group and its members visible on these hosts. So if this chain of references is not complete, an user object is not seen. And this is quite nice. There's also another, you can also distinguish a little bit access rights in some sense, because you can also say you don't, additionally you define which user groups have login rights on the target systems. This is by setting the reference attribute AE login groups. So you can also distinguish whether groups and their members are only visible or whether they also have the login right. there are more attributes. I call this somewhat permission attributes. I come to that later. And you also have to make pseudo rules applicable on the systems explicitly available, just like the groups with the attribute a visible pseudos. If you have any question in between, don't hesitate to ask. Yeah? So there are some basic roles. There are mainly there are two global admin and auditor roles. AE admins, they can delegate. They can do everything, you know. But in their daily work, they only delegate zones. They create zone entries. They might fix broken entries, but they do not maintain normal data within the zones. They're really advised to keep out of the daily data maintenance business. It's the highest role, they can do everything, but they should not help the normal zone admins to do the normal data work. Yeah, so because they do not know about all the data in different zones. You know, they don't know the context of some objects stored there. You know, they just maintain idea itself. as such, also AE auditors, they can read everything. It's if you have security audits going on or something, you can give a temporary account to a security auditor coming to your company, but he cannot write anything except his own password. So, and the daily work, really maintaining users, putting them in groups and stuff like this, is done by the zone admins, and they have this role delegated by the zone definition. And obviously there's also a need for giving people read-only access to zones, for example, yeah? So that, for example, zone admins of two different zones can work together by giving each other read access to their own zone. And yeah, users may read their own entries, for example, to comply to privacy regulations, they can ask which data is stored about me. And obviously they can change their password. So, I'm looking on open LDAP mailing lists since 20 years, and one of the main hurdles for people setting up a user management based on open LDAP is schema. People really hate it sometimes, you know, and I can somewhat understand it because there are various different schemas. You have to find out whether to use one, and it also depends on the client applications which schema they need and stuff like this. So it can be confusing for people starting to get into it. And therefore, I try to define a schema which accommodates every client out there I know of. So, so it's basically it's based on standard schema like INET org person for personal data, or the RFC 2307, the POSIX account, POSIX group schema, the very old one. but it also has custom schema in there. So the goal with the schema design was to behave like any normal LDAP server out there to the client, but still you need to store some additional metadata. Yeah, and this is but this is not data usually used by the external clients, yeah? So so each object has an abstract object class called AE object, and there you have some metadata like status, a status attribute or description or something like a time span the entry can be used. And one of the real issues with if you want to do Unix login systems is choosing the right group schema, because there are basically two variants of the POSIX group schema, which is an old one, which has the username stored in a member UID attribute, and another more recent schema where where you store the membership into the member attribute. And this is not compatible. So people run usually into problems which schema to choose, and sometimes they're not free. So I solved this problem by having a hybrid group schema which just serves both from the same group entry. Okay, so what's very important if you're doing authorization is uniqueness of identifiers. I sometimes wonder why I have to repeat this so often, but uniqueness, if you don't enforce uniqueness, you're not able to implement a secure access control policy. So, of course, usernames have to be unique. UID numbers, the POSIX UID and the POSIX GID have to be unique. But also group names. Yeah? Or, for example, also very interesting, the host names, for example, or even having something like even storing something like a unique, fully qualified domain name for example, network addresses. And you can do all this here. So basically, you can add host objects and their network data. So you can even have uniqueness enforced on the DNS names of the IP addresses, and also enforce uniqueness, for example, on MAC addresses, so that you can find out who is responsible for that name. And you can do a lot of interesting stuff with this. For example, network access control, or determine in a PKI who is allowed to request a server certificate for a certain fully qualified domain name. Okay, I have to... Oh, time is running. So I will hurry up a little bit because I'm famous to have too many slides. Installation of AEDIA is completely Ansible-based. You mainly define the inventory, run the Ansible play, and you're done. And then all the replicas and web applications are up and running. In the meantime, it proved to be very stable, very robust. It corrects former configuration faults, and it works pretty well. By default, I'm trying to really apply some security principles and use as many security mechanisms available. For example, okay, it's self-contained, I already said this, but I'm also using by default some systemd options which harden the system by calling ZNS calls by doing ZNS calls and restrict the processes to namespaces. And for each of the components you saw in the system architecture, there's an AppArmor profile defined for that. And there's also built-in YubiKey-based or HOTP-based two-factor authentication. You can mainly use with YubiKeys. I skipped this. This is a little bit... You can read about this a little bit on the website, because that's an authorizing SSH proxy, which is basically a pretty good thing. So, last summer I've even developed an NSS PAM service for the whole stuff, because formerly we used SSSD for this, but if you have, for example, 15,000 systems, the access control is pretty demanding. So, going back to this, really determining which users are visible on a system, the Open LDAP server has to work its way through all the references with so-called set-based access control. And the set-based ACLs are pretty CPU consuming. So if you have many clients, like 15,000 or so, you're burning a lot of CPU cycles. You're burning a lot of electrical power. So for doing something for the environment, yeah, so therefore, okay, the reason for this is that the clients are deliberately configured dump. They don't need, you don't configure something like, oh, I just want to have users of this group on the client, because this would be very inflexible. So even if you have configuration management, you would have to change the access control in the directory and then apply configuration to the clients. I don't want that. So the clients are really dumb. They just query the LDAP server saying, oh, give me everything I'm allowed to see. Yeah, so mainly they are doing this. So this burns a lot of CPU cycles. And another thing is, every host and every service has to authenticate itself, so mainly by a host password. And I needed a better way to automatically enroll many hosts. And the customer using this, he also used sudo LDAP, which does an LDAP connection for each sudo, and that's also lots of TLS connection. And also the connection behavior of clients like SSSD, you cannot really influence that. You know, I wanted to implement some kind of a client-side load balancing. You know, for mass of NSSPAM clients, and having an own service, it's also possible to implement some features I was tired to ask for. Okay, better performance, better behavior of lots of clients, automated enrollment, and especially have less configuration, less code, which is security relevant, and less dependencies. So AU host A, for example, has no dependency on systemd and dbus, for example. So how does it look like? You see here normal SSHD, SSH server, and the server mainly uses NSS and PAM. NSS for querying which users are available on the system, which groups, and which IDs they have, and check, for example, a password or an authorization through PAM. And basically, these two modules I didn't implement. What I've implemented is just the AE host day here. These two modules are the PAM and NSS front-end modules of NSS PAM LDAPD, also known as NSLCD. Okay, so basically I replaced NSLCD by this component. And this component does several things, of course, providing passphrase group maps, but it also provides, in opposite to SSD, for example, it also provides the host map, which can be a nice fallback in some cases. And it also queries which sudoers rules are available for this system, and syncs it to the etc sudoers directory. Basically, there are two instances running, and this was also something important to me, because in normal setups, SSSD is running as root. I don't want that. I don't want to have a networked component just running as root. So I have a non-privileged user running the AE host day for getting the data, and I have a privileged additional component putting, for example, sudoers rules in place. Okay, so there are some specific features also. The permissions group I showed before, for example, login or log view groups also, they are put into virtual groups in the etc host in the etc group map. I show an example. So we are here on a normal client, and this is a user. We can do the usual stuff. For example, you see here, okay, they're coming AED user accounts. And those accounts have, of course, a unique POSIX ID, but they also have a unique POSIX GID. And if I call ID on one of the users, you can see that there's a virtual group object delivered in the group maps, in the groups map, for its primary POSIX GID, even though the entry does not exist. And there are virtual groups, for example, like those are fixed GIDs, which have a local meaning here, you know. So all members of all groups who have log view rights are merged into this virtual group, And you can use this, for example, to give read access to var log messages or something for the group, yeah, which is pretty handy actually. And the AE host AE also syncs the SSH authorized key to the system. And there are some specific features, like if you are doing a PAM request, then it also sends the so-called LDAP session control, LDAP session tracking control to the LDAP server, and then the IP address of the SSH client is really appearing in the log of the Open LDAP server, which is pretty handy for security audits and forensics. So, and the enrollment, each client needs a password. And if you do this with SSSD or with another daemon, basically if you are deploying your machines, for example, with a Pixie boot and you have AutoYAST installation or pre-seed or Kickstarter or whatever, the machine comes up and most people then do something like have a generic local login there and then log in with this local login and apply the configuration afterwards, after deploying the machine. So obviously, for some time, you have a gap in your security policy. So you have a freshly installed machine, and in your directory, there's the security policy defined for it, but it's not applied yet, yeah, because you didn't have you didn't do the configuration step. So my goal was to say, okay, the machine starts. It knows where to connect the directory servers, where to query for the security policy, but it cannot do this yet because it doesn't have its password yet. So what I'm mainly doing is just a pseudo PAM login with a pseudo user, and if you do this, it checks the password you provide here against its own host password. And if that matches, it just writes it down into its own configuration. And this is pretty neat, because if you ever try to do something like a secure domain join of a host with Active Directory, for example, yeah, you always have this little gap between setting up the machine and the need for a local administrative account before you can really apply the configuration enforcing the security policy. And that's nice here, because you don't have the gap. You just fire the host password on it, you know, and if it's right, the host password, then it will be used. Okay, so, yeah, security by design is possible. It's painful for all people involved, especially also the user. Sometimes it's painful. You have to encourage people to use it. You have to teach them, and of course, some backing of the management regarding budget helps. And for me, one of the conclusions of this project is I'm now running this open source project for quite a while. I'm having a lot of ideas what to do, but I'm always very cautious not to break security promises I did before. So I have to discipline myself not to add a feature which defeats another security promise I made before. So that's the conclusion. Okay, some links, documentation. It's yeah, not so bad, the docs. And there's also an online demo you can write, play, click there. And some more information about the two-factor authentication. Yeah, and that's it. Do you have any questions?
Thank you. You mentioned one of the first slides two different groups, visible groups and login groups. Also, I think the login groups in the middle and visible groups below them. What's the difference? Mm-hmm. Why do you distinguish?
The motivation was that on some servers you just need, for example, the passvd and group map data, but people do not have to log in. For example, file servers, plain file servers. You know, they need the NSS map data, you know, to enforce the local file restrictions. But okay. you don't have any need to really log on this NFS server, for example, on
yeah, okay,
SSH.
Understand.
And technically, this is the distinction is that being a member in a login group gives the host read access to the SSH public key attribute, to the SSH authorized key, and gives search access to the PVD changed attribute, not to the so actually a host can really determine whether somebody has login right by just searching the user with a certain filter. I show an example. So this is a very stupid configuration, how to do a simple mod LDAP integration for Apache. And and in this step, if you're logging in with this simple HTTP basic authentication, the Apache web server has to map your user ID to the distinguished name of the directory entry before checking the password. And so it has to search for the user account. And basically, if you add this filter component to your search filter, the search will only return a result if the user is in one of the groups in the login groups. Yeah. So you don't have to configure anything site specific here. You just advise the LDAP server to follow the ACLs, you know, and then you get a result if it has the login right or not. And this is pretty handy.
Yeah, that answers my second question. Is a login only limited to SSH login or limited for any service login?
Yeah, for any service login.
Okay, thanks.
Always provided that the service can use LDAP in any way. Yeah. So, any other question? Okay. Who of you are member of the OpenSUSE Heroes? Okay, two of you. Last year I did a proposal for the OpenSUSE project because I heard that the free IPA instance used as a base for the logins to the infrastructure systems is running on Fedora. So my proposal was to replace this to, because it runs also on OpenSUSE. Yeah. So, I mean, it's just two of you. Let's discuss later whether that's a viable option for you. And any more questions? Okay. Thank you for your attention.